Yes, I am gonna say that I'm a thug. That's because I came from the gutter and I'm still here.
Tupac Shakur was an American rapper and actor who came to embody the 1990s gangster rap aesthetic and who in death became an icon symbolizing noble struggle. He has sold 75 million albums to date, making him one of the top-selling artists of all time. A sensitive, precociously talented, and troubled soul, Tupac was gunned down in Las Vegas on September 7th, 1996, and died 6 days later. His murder has never been solved. Before we go any further, I want to talk to you about something I am trying to do. So I and my team are trying to build this channel, the 10X channel, into one of the most successful YouTube channels around the globe. And we know it sounds all stupid and unachievable, but in all honesty, it's just one subscriber at a time. So just take a second out of your precious time to leave me a like, then drop a comment in the comment section below telling me what issues in the world you want to see us make videos about. Once you've done that, go ahead and smash that red subscribe button and turn on the notification bell icon beside it so you get notified by YouTube when I drop your requested video. And now that I know that you've liked, commented, subscribed, and turned on notifications, let's now dive deep into the life of the legend, Tupac. Tupac began his music career as a rebel with a cause to articulate the travails and injustices endured by many African Americans. His skill in doing so made him a spokesperson not just for his own generation, but for subsequent ones who continue to face the same struggle for equality. In life, his biggest battle was sometimes with himself, as fate drove him towards the nihilism of gangster rap and into the arms of the controversial Death Row Records impresario Suge Knight. The boundaries between Shakur's art and his life became increasingly blurred, with tragic consequences. Tupac was born on June 16, 1971 in Harlem, New York. His mother, Afeni, was raising two children on her own and struggled for money. The family moved homes often, sometimes staying in shelters. He attended 8th grade at Roland Park Middle School, and then 2 years at Paul Lawrence Dunbar High School. They moved to Baltimore, where Tupac enrolled in the prestigious Baltimore School for the Arts, at which he felt the freest he ever felt. On transfer to Baltimore School for the Arts, he studied acting, poetry, jazz, and ballet. He performed in Shakespeare's plays depicting timeless themes now seen in gang warfare, he would recall, and as the Mouse King role in the Nutcracker Ballet. Tupac was named Lasan Parrish Crooks at birth. After joining the Black Panther Party, his mother changed his first name to Tupac Amaru, a Peruvian revolutionary who was killed by the Spanish. Tupac later took his surname from his sister's Sekia's father, another panther called Mutulu Shakur. Tupac's mother, Alice Faye Williams, was the daughter of a North Carolina maid and a high school dropout. She became pregnant with Tupac in 1970 while on bail after being charged with conspiring to set off a race war. Afeni was acquitted the following year after successfully defending herself in court, displaying a gift for oration that her son would inherit. She changed her name to Afeni Shakur after becoming actively involved with the Black Panther Party. Afeni died in May of 2016 at the age of 69. Tupac's father, Billy Garland, was also a Panther but lost contact with Afeni when Tupac was 5 years old. The rapper would not see his father again until he was 23. "I thought my father was dead all my life," he told the writer Kevin Powell during an interview with Vibe magazine in 1996. "I felt I needed a daddy to show me the ropes, and I didn't have one." Afeni gave birth to a daughter, Sekia, 2 years after Tupac. However, Sekia's father, Mutulu Shakur, didn't stick around either. Tupac met actress Jada Pinkett Smith in high school at the Baltimore School for the Arts in Maryland. She had a cameo in his music video, Strictly for My Niggas. Pinkett Smith was featured in the 2017 movie on Tupac, All Eyes on Me. She later told reporters that she was a drug dealer when she met Tupac and that she found the reimagining of their relationship in the film very hurtful. It wasn't just about, oh, you have this cute girl and this cool guy, they must have been in this. Nah, it wasn't that at all. It was about survival, and it had always been about survival between us, she said. Tupac's Baltimore neighborhood was riven by crime, so the family moved to Marin City, California. It turned out to be a mean little ghetto, according to Robert Sam Anderson's comprehensive posthumous feature on Tupac for Vanity Fair in 1997. It was in Marin City that Afeni succumbed to crack addiction, a drug her son, Tupac, would sell on the same streets where his mother bought her supply. Tupac's love for hip-hop would steer him away from a life of crime, for a while at least. At 17, in the spring of 1989, he met an older white woman, Layla Steinberg, in a park. They struck up a conversation about Winnie Mandela. Steinberg would later recall a young man with fan-like eyelashes, overflowing charisma, and the most infectious laugh. By the time they met, Tupac was obsessively writing poetry and convinced Steinberg, who had no music industry experience, to become his manager. Steinberg was eventually able to get Tupac in front of music manager Atron Gregory, who secured a gig for him in 1990 as a roadie and dancer for the hip-hop group Digital Underground. He soon stepped up to the mic, making his recording debut in 1991 on Same Song, which soundtracked the Dan Aykroyd comedy Nothing But Trouble. Tupac also appeared on Digital Underground's album Sons of P in October that year. After the band's manager, Gregory, took over from Steinberg, he landed Tupac a deal with Interscope Records. A month after Sons of P hit the stores came Tupacalypse Now, Tupac's debut album as a solo artist. Tupac often complained that he was misunderstood. "Everything in life isn't all beautiful," he told journalist Chuck Phillips. "There is a lot of killings and drugs. To me, a perfect album talks about the hard stuff and the fun and caring stuff. The thing that bothers me is that it seems like all the sensitive stuff I write just goes unnoticed." On August 22, 1992, in Marin City, Shakur performed outdoors at a festival. For about an hour after the performance, he signed autographs and posed for photos. A conflict broke out, and Shakur allegedly drew a legally carried Colt Mustang but dropped it on the ground. Shakur claimed that someone with them then picked it up when it accidentally discharged. About 100 yards, roughly 90 meters away, in a schoolyard, Cade Walker Teal, a boy aged 6 on his bicycle, was fatally shot in the forehead. Police matched the bullet to a .38 caliber pistol registered to Shakur. His stepbrother, Maurice Harding, was arrested, but no charges were filed. Lack of witnesses stymied prosecution. In 1995, Cade's mother filed a wrongful death suit against Shakur, settled for about $300,000 to $500,000. In October 1993 in Atlanta, Mark and Scott Whitwell, two brothers who were both off-duty police officers, were out celebrating with their wives after one of them had passed the state's bar examination. Drunk, the officers were crossing the street when a passing car carrying Shakur allegedly almost struck them. The Whitwells, later found to have stolen guns, argued with the car's occupants. When a second car arrived, the Whitwells ran away as Shakur shot one officer in the buttocks and the other in the leg, back, or abdomen. Shakur was charged in the shooting. Mark Whitwell was charged with firing at Shakur's car and later with making false statements to investigators. Prosecutors ultimately dropped all charges against both parties. Both brothers filed civil suits against Shakur. Mark Whitwell's was settled out of court, while Scott Whitwell's $2 million suit resulted in a default judgment entered against the rapper's estate. The case illustrated the misrepresentation of African-American males and the attitude of some police towards them, which Tupac had been talking about in his music. What was portrayed as gun-toting gangster behavior by a lawless individual turned out to be an act of self-defense by a young man in fear of his life. All the while, Tupac's star continued to rise. On April 5, 1993, charged with felonious assault, Shakur allegedly threw a microphone and swung a baseball bat at rapper Shaunsay Wynn of the group MAD at a concert in Michigan State University. On September 14, 1994, Shakur pleaded guilty to a misdemeanor and was sentenced to 30 days in jail, 20 of them suspended, and ordered to 35 hours of community service. Slated to star as Sharif in the 1993 Hugh Brothers film Menace to Society, Shakur was replaced by actor Vontae Sweet after allegedly assaulting one of the film's directors, Alan Hughes. In early 1994, Shakur served 15 days in jail after being found guilty of the assault. The prosecution's evidence included a Yo MTV Raps interview where Shakur boasts that he had beat up the director of Menace to Society. Before Tupac released his third album, there was more trouble. On November 30th, 1994, while in New York, Tupac was recording verses for a mixtape of Ron G. Tupac was repeatedly distracted by his beeper. It was his music manager, James Jimmy Henchman Rosemond, reportedly offering Tupac $7,000 to stop by Quad Studios in Times Square that night to record a verse for his client, Lil Sean. Tupac was leery, but needing cash to offset steepening legal costs, took the gig. Tupac arrived with Stretch and one or two others. In the lobby, three men robbed and beat him at gunpoint.
Tupac resisted and was shot. Shakur speculated that the shooting had been a setup. Tupac believed his rap rival Biggie Smalls was behind the shooting, for which nobody has ever been charged. Smalls always denied he knew anything. In 2011, Dexter Isaac, a New York prisoner serving a life sentence for an unrelated crime, claimed he was paid to steal from Tupac by the artist, manager, and mogul James Henchman Roseman, and shot the rapper during the robbery. 3 hours after surgery, against doctor's advice, Shakur checked out of Bellevue Hospital Center. The next day, in a Manhattan courtroom, bandaged in a wheelchair, he received the jury's verdict in his ongoing criminal trial for a November 1993 sexual assault in his hotel room. Convicted of 3 counts of sexual assault, he was acquitted of 6 other charges, including sodomy and gun charges. In June 1996, Tupac released a diss track, Hit 'Em Up, aimed at Biggie Smalls and his label boss, Bad Boy Records, Sean Diddy Combs, ratcheting up the tension between East and West Coast rap. Their rivalry was fast becoming hip-hop's most famous and ugliest beef. Within 3 months, Tupac was murdered. In February of 1995, Tupac was sentenced to between 1.5 and 4.5 years of jail time for sexually abusing a female fan. The case related to an incident that had taken place in Tupac's suite in the New York Parker Meridian Hotel in November 1993. Shakur and 3 other men were charged in New York with sexually assaulting a woman in his hotel room. The woman, Ayanna Jackson, alleged that after consensual oral sex in his hotel room, she returned a day later, but then was raped by him and the other men there. Interviewed on the Arsenio Hall show, Shakur said he was hurt that a woman would accuse me of taking something from her. On December 1, 1994, Shakur was convicted of first-degree sexual abuse but acquitted of associated sodomy and gun charges. In February of 1995, he was sentenced to 18 months to 4.5 years in prison by a judge who decried an act of brutal violence against a helpless woman. On October 12, 1995, pending judicial appeal, Shakur was released from Clinton Correctional Facility. Tupac maintained that he hadn't raped the girl, although he confessed to the Vibe magazine journalist Kevin Powell that he could have prevented others who were present in the suite from doing so. "I had a job to protect her," he said, expressing his sorrow, "and I never showed up." While Tupac was in prison on rape charges, his mother was about to lose her house. Tupac had his wife, Keisha Morris, get word to Marion Suge Knight in Los Angeles, boss of Death Row Records. Reportedly, Tupac's mother promptly received $15,000. Tupac was visited by Suge Knight, the notorious label boss of Death Row Records. Knight offered to post the $1.4 million bail Tupac needed to be released pending his appeal. The condition was that Tupac would sign onto Death Row. Tupac duly signed. He was released from the high-security Denimore facility in New York in October 1995. On April 5, 1996, Shakur was sentenced to 120 days in jail for violating his terms of release by failing to appear for a road cleanup job, but on June 8, his sentence was deferred via appeals pending in other cases. At the same time as he was glorifying an outlaw lifestyle for Death Row, Tupac was financing an at-risk youth center, bankrolling South Central sports teams, setting up a telephone helpline for young people with problems, all noted in Robert Sam Anson's Vanity Fair article published after Tupac's death. Before we talk about Shakur's albums, let's have a look at his life in the world of rap. In 1988, Randy Stretch Walker, along with his brother, dubbed Majesty, and a friend, debuted with an EP as rap group and production team Live Squad in the Queens Borough of New York City. Tupac's early days with the Digital Underground made his acquaintance with Stretch, who featured on a track of the Digital Underground's 1991 album, Sons of the P. Becoming fast friends, Tupac and Stretch recorded and performed together often. Stretch, as well as Live Squad, contributed tracks on Tupac's first 2 albums, first November 1991, then February 1993, and on Tupac's side group Thug Life's only album in September of 1994. The end of Tupac's and Stretch's friendship in late 1994 surprised the New York rap scene. The next Tupac album, released in March 1995, lacks Stretch, and Tupac's album after that, released in February 1996, has lines suggesting Stretch's impending death for betrayal. No objective evidence will publicly emerge to tangibly incriminate Stretch in the gun attack on Tupac, while with Stretch and 2 others at about 12:30 on November 30th, 1994. In any case, after a Live Squad production session for the second album of Queens rapper Nas, Stretch's vehicle was chased while receiving fatal gunfire at about 12:30 a.m. on November 30th, 1995. During 1993 and 1994, the Biggie Smalls guest verses on several singles, often R&B like Mary J. Blige's What's the 401 remix, set high expectations for his debut album. The perfectionism of Puffy, still forming his Bad Boy label, extended its recording to 18 months. In 1993, visiting Los Angeles, Biggie asked a local drug dealer for an introduction to Tupac, who then welcomed Biggie and Biggie's friends to Tupac's house and treated them to recreational activities. On later visits to Los Angeles, Biggie would stay at Tupac's place, and when in New York, Tupac would go to Brooklyn and hang out with Biggie and his circle. During this period, at his own live shows, Tupac would call Biggie on stage to rap with him and Stretch. Together, they recorded the songs Running from the Police and House of Pain. Reportedly, Biggie asked Tupac to manage him, whereupon Tupac advised him that Puffy would make him a star. Yet, in the meantime, Tupac's lifestyle was comparatively lavish, whereas Biggie appeared to continue wearing the same pair of boots for perhaps a year. Tupac welcomed Biggie to join his side group, Thug Life. Biggie would instead form his own group, the Junior Mafia, with his Brooklyn friends Lil Cease and Lil' Kim on Bad Boy. By some accounts, the role Birdie, played by Shakur in the 1994 film Above the Rim, had been modeled on a New York underworld tough Jack Haitian Jack Agnew, a manager and promoter of rappers. Reportedly, Shakur met him at a Queens nightclub where, noticing him amid women and champagne, Shakur asked for an introduction. Reportedly, Biggie asked Tupac to avoid him, but Tupac disregarded the warning. In November of 1993, in his hotel room in Manhattan, Shakur received a woman's return visit. Soon, she alleged sexual assault by him and three other men there: his road manager, Charles Fuller, aged 24, one Ricardo Brown, aged 30, and a Nigel, later understood as Haitian Jack. In November of 1994, Jack's case was split off and closed via misdemeanor plea without incarceration. In 2007, for shooting at someone, he would be deported. Yet, in November 1994, AJ Benza in the New York Daily News reported Tupac's new disdain for Jack. Tupac had released a total of 11 platinum albums, 4 during his career and 7 more released posthumously. To date, Tupac sold more than 75 million records worldwide. As of September 2017, the Recording Industry Association of America, RIAA, listed Tupac as the 44th top-selling artist of all time by album sales and streaming figures. Tupac's first album as a solo artist was Tupacalypse Now. Although it didn't yield any hits, it sold a respectable 500,000 copies and established Tupac as an uncompromising social commentator on songs such as Brenda's Got a Baby, which narrates an underaged mother's fall into destitution, and Soulja's Story, which controversially spoke of blasting a police officer and dropping the cop. The song was cited as motivation for a real-life cop killing by a teenage car thief called Roland Ray Howard, and was condemned by the then US Vice President Dan Quayle. "There has been absolutely no reason for a record like this to be published," Quayle said. "It has no place in our society." With those words, Tupac's notoriety was guaranteed. Tupac's second album, Strictly For My Niggas, dropped in February of 1993. It continued in the same socially conscious vein as his debut. On the gold-certified single, Keep Your Head Up, he emphasized with "My sister's on the welfare," encouraging them to please don't cry, dry your eyes, and never let up. The album featured contributions from Tupac's stepbrother, Mopreme. Mopreme became a member of the hip-hop group Thug Life, which Tupac started and which released the album Thug Life, Volume 1 in 1994. When Tupac's third solo album came out on March 14, 1995, he was in jail. Its title, Me Against the World, could not have been more apt. It reached number 1 in the Billboard 200 chart and is considered by many to be his magnum opus, by and large a work of pain, anger, and burning desperation. But there was vulnerability too. Lead single, Dear Mama, was a tear-jerking tribute to his mother, Afeni, that hit number 9 on the Billboard Hot 100 in April 1995. Tupac's debut for Death Row, the double-length album All Eyes on Me, came out in February of 1996, with his new hip-hop group Outlaws debuting the album. All Eyes on Me was an unapologetic celebration of the thug lifestyle, eschewing socially conscious lyrics in favor of gangsta funk hedonism and menace. Dr. Dre, who had pioneered G-Funk with N.W.A., produced the album's first single, California Love, which went number 1 on the Billboard Hot 100 and remains Tupac's best-known song. The third single from the album, How Do You Want It, also reached number 1. Within 2 months of its release, All Eyes on Me had been certified 5 times double platinum. It would eventually become diamond certified. Released as a single in June 1996, How Do You Want It was more famous for its B-track, Hit 'Em Up, which aired Tupac's West Coast feud with East Coast bad boy rivals. On the inflammatory song, Tupac spat venom at artists including Biggie Smalls, Lil' Kim, Junior Mafia, and Prodigy of Mobb Deep. The track seemed to chillingly presage Tupac's death and the ensuing conspiracy theories. Grab your Glocks when you see Tupac. Call the cops when you see Tupac. Who shot me but your points didn't finish, now you're about to feel the wrath of a menace, he rapped. Tupac's fifth album, Donk Illuminati, The 7-Day Theory, was released in November 1996, just 8 weeks after his death. It also reached number one on the charts. Tupac recorded a total of 6 studio albums released posthumously, up to and including Pac's Life in 2006. Before Tupac became a rapper, he wrote poetry. The world moves fast and would rather pass you by than to stop and see what makes you cry. In one verse he wrote as a teenager that would eventually be published in the 2000 book, The Rose That Grew From Concrete. Along with his music, Tupac had appeared in several films by the time of his death, among them starring roles alongside Janet Jackson in 1993's Poetic Justice and Mickey Rourke in 1996's Bullet. Tupac married Keisha Morris in 1995 while he was still in prison. The couple had met several months earlier at a nightclub when Morris was 20 and Tupac was 21. Their marriage was annulled 5 months after Tupac was released from jail in October 1995. The pair remained friends until his death. Soon after his marriage to Morris ended, Tupac began dating Kidada Jones. They had met at a club when Tupac apologized for insulting her father, Quincy Jones, for only dating white women. Jones was in Las Vegas with Tupac the night he was shot. Tupac died in Las Vegas on September 13, 1996, of gunshot wounds inflicted 6 days prior. His murder remains unsolved. On September 7th, Tupac was in Las Vegas with Knight to watch a Mike Tyson fight at the MGM Grand Hotel. There was a scuffle after the bout between a member of the Crips gang and Tupac. Knight, who was involved with the rival Bloods gang and members of his entourage, piled in. At about 11 p.m. on Las Vegas Boulevard, bicycle-mounted police stopped the car for its loud music and lack of license plates. The plates were found in the trunk and the car was released without a ticket. At about 11:15 at a stoplight, a white 4-door late model Cadillac sedan pulled up to the passenger side and the occupant rapidly fired into the car. The man fired 13 shots. Tupac was struck 4 times. The bullet hit him in the hand, pelvis, and chest, with one of the bullets entering his right lung. Shards hit Knight's head. Frank Alexander, Shakur's bodyguard, was not in the car at the time. He would say he had been tasked to drive the car of Shakur's girlfriend, Kidada Jones. Shakur was taken to the University Medical Center of Southern Nevada, where he was heavily sedated and put on life support. In the intensive care unit on the afternoon of September 13, 1996, Shakur died from internal bleeding. He was pronounced dead at 4:03 p.m. The official causes of death are respiratory failure and cardiopulmonary arrest associated with multiple gunshot wounds. His girlfriend, Kidada, and his mother, Afeni, were both with him in his final days. Tupac's body was cremated. Members of his old band, Outlaws, made the controversial claim that they had smoked some of his ashes in honor of him. His mother announced that she would scatter her son's ashes in Soweto, South Africa, the birthplace of his ancestors, on the 10th anniversary of his murder. She later changed the date to June 16, 1997, Tupac's 26th birthday, as well as the anniversary of the 1976 Soweto uprising. On March 9, 1997, 6 months after Tupac died, Biggie Smalls was killed in a drive-by shooting in Los Angeles. His murder has never been solved either. Tupac died of gunshot wounds in 1996. However, conspiracy theories have raged ever since Tupac was shot, as his murder has never been solved. Fans have speculated that Tupac faked his death. On his album, Life Goes On, Tupac rapped about his funeral. His song, I Ain't Mad At Ya, was released 2 days after he died. There have been several reported potential Tupac sightings since his death, including in 2012 by Kim Kardashian. In 2002, investigative journalist Chuck Phillips, after a year of work, reported in the Los Angeles Times that Anderson, a Southside Compton Crip, having been attacked by Suge and Shakur's entourage at the MGM Hotel after the boxing match, had fired the fatal gunshots, but that Las Vegas police had interviewed him only once, briefly, before his death in an unrelated shooting. Phillips' 2002 article also alleges the involvement of Christopher Notorious B.I.G. Wallace and several within the New York City's criminal underworld. Both Anderson and Wallace denied involvement. While Wallace offered a confirmed alibi, music journalist John Leland in the New York Times called the evidence inconclusive. In 2005, Death Row released a DVD, Tupac, Live at the House of Blues, his final recorded live performance, an event on July 4, 1996. In August 2006, Tupac Shakur, Legacy, an interactive biography by Jamal Joseph, arrived with previously unpublished family photographs, intimate stories, and over 20 detachable copies of his handwritten song lyrics, contracts, scripts, poetry, and other papers. In 2006, the Tupac album, Pac's Life, was released and, like the previous, was among the recording industry's most popular releases. In 2008, his estate made about $15 million. In September 2017, Knight hinted that Tupac might be alive in an interview. When I left the hospital, me and Pac was laughing and joking. I don't see how someone can go from doing well to doing bad, said Knight, adding that with Pac, you never know if he could be alive and living in secret somewhere. In early 2018, BET aired an episode of Death Row Chronicles in which former Crips member Dwayne Keith D. Keith Davis admitted that he was riding in the car with the man who killed Tupac. He declined to identify the shooter in the interview, revealing only that the shots came from the back seat. Though he had earlier told federal investigators that the gun was in the hands of his nephew, Orlando Anderson, now deceased. The revelation fueled the launch of a Change.org petition that called for the Las Vegas Metropolitan Police Department to declare the case cleared. It also led to the rumors that new arrest warrants were pending, but the LVMPD shot down the rumors in July, saying that they were reviewing the details of what remains an open homicide case. While serving time in prison, Tupac wrote a letter to Madonna, where he ended relations with the pop star because of her race. The letter, dated January 15, 1995 at 4:30 a.m., was verified to be authentic by news outlets including Rolling Stone. In July 2017, Tupac's letter to Madonna was set to go on auction and was expected to bring $100,000. In 2018, Madonna brought a lawsuit against the art consultant and online auction house behind the auction to stop the sale. A judge threw out her suit, citing a release that Madonna signed in 2004. Madonna lost her appeal at the Appellate Court in June 2019. The letter was put on auction in July of 2019. The letter explains why Tupac was ending their relationship. For you to be seen with a black man wouldn't in any way jeopardize your career. If anything, it would make you seem much more open and exciting, he wrote. But for me, at least, in my previous perception, I felt due to my image, I would be letting down half of the people who made me what I thought I was. I never meant to hurt you. Tupac also apologized. Like you said, I haven't been the kind of friend I know I'm capable of being, he said. Adding that he'd grown both spiritually and mentally and was no longer the young man with limited experience with an extremely famous sex symbol. On November 21st, 2017, A&E aired the six-part biography, Who Killed Tupac, which followed civil rights attorney Benjamin Crump on his investigation into key theories behind Tupac's 1996 killing. On April 7th, 2017, Tupac was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, one of music's highest honors, a worthy inclusion for a rapper hailed by many to have been the greatest of all time. That's all we have for you today. If you enjoyed watching the video, go ahead and demolish that like button. Then, like I said earlier, tell me in the comment section below what subjects or issues in the world you want to see us make videos about. Finally, don't forget to smash that red subscribe button and hit the notification button beside it so you get notified when we drop the video on the topic you requested. With that all said, I'll see you in the next video. Let's go.